join us. We're going to start our worship service in a moment. Before we begin, though, we always start with a scripture, a call to worship to help us focus our attention on the Lord. Isaiah 12:4 is our call to worship this morning. It's from Isaiah 12:4. Give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name. Make known among the nations what he has done, and proclaim that his name is exalted. Please join me as we pray. Heavenly Father, we are here to proclaim your name, Lord, to lift up your name, to exalt you, to honor you, Lord. We recognize our state, and we thank you, Lord, for your salvation, and we want to rejoice in that this morning. Bless this time of worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We thank you for being here with us this morning, Lord. We thank you that you are in control over every situation, of every hardship that we have, of every good thing that we have, Lord. That is all. We know that you are there with us, Lord. We thank you that you're there in our families. You're there in our issues. You're there for us when we need you most, Lord. And we can never do that for ourselves, Lord. Only you can pull us out of what it is that we're in, Lord. And we thank you that you are there with us, Lord. We thank you that you're here today. We thank you that we can worship you today. We pray that you be with us for the message today. Open our ears to what it is that you want us to hear. And we thank you for always being magnificent and glorious and above it all, Lord. We praise you this morning. You are holier than holy, Lord. You are awesome. And with you, anything is possible. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Before you sit down, please take a moment and say hello to somebody.
See all of you here at our first hour of worship. If you could take out your blue sheets, let me go through a few announcements. A payment is due for this trip to Sight and Sound. You can see that at the top. Our Wednesday night family night is still going strong. We only have a couple of more left. It ends the end of May. So we have Bible study in here. We have the youth group, the kids club. We have Moms Connect. We have childcare. So if you're available, we certainly would love to have you come. Now, next Saturday, we've got a few things going on. We're going to have a church work day. We're going to put some mulch down. We're going to trim some branches. We're going to work around the church. And also, we're going to have a VBS work day where they get all of the decorations for VBS ready. So there are a couple of sign-up sheets in the foyer. I hope that all of you will come out. Look, if you're not doing anything in the church, this is what you should do. This is like one time a year for a couple hours. So get involved in that if you can. And then also there's a volunteer training for VBS on June 12th. If you need any prayer, we're available after the service. On the other side of the sheets, of course, is the most important insert, and that is your prayer request. If you have a prayer need or if you know someone who does, please fill that out. The basket is in the foyer, in the corner of the sanctuary where you can drop it off on your way out. We get copies of these later on today, and then we lift them up throughout the week as we do our quiet time. So having said that, now is our time for our corporate prayer. I will lead us, so let's bow our heads and come before our holy God, shall we? Dear Heavenly Father, again, as I say every Sunday, we love to come here and give you that praise, glory, worship, love, adoration that only you deserve. I will praise you, O Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of your wonders. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing to your name, O Most High. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord who is worthy of praise, and I have saved from my enemies. Lord, again, you deserve all of our praise, all of our love. You created us. We are the sheep of your pasture, Lord. Everything we have comes from your gracious hand. We acknowledge that here today, Lord. Our society does not, but we certainly do. And we thank you for all the many blessings that you give to us, Lord. And Lord, help us to value your word. Help us to value your law, your moral precepts, and your guidance and direction. Again, we remember the psalmist when he says, "The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure and enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are sure and altogether righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey, honey from the comb. By them your servant is warned, and keeping them is great reward." Lord, when are we going to learn that when we follow your commands, when we follow your guidance and the precepts that are in your word, it's always in our own best interest? When are we going to learn that, Lord? Help us to learn that. Help us to understand that, Lord. And Lord, give us strength in these most trying times. Help us to live as you want us to live, to act as you want us to act. Help us to keep our sin natures in check, Lord, when we see all the ungodliness and the lies and the deceit and the pain and suffering that goes on around us. Lord, we certainly lift up our nation. We lift up those who are hurting today, those who are in trouble. People who have difficulty finding baby formula and putting food on the table and paying their monthly bills and putting gas in their car, Lord. We're aware of all of these things, Lord. We ask you, please inspire our leaders to follow biblical principles as they make decisions and policies that affect all of us. Lord, please lift up and help and support our Supreme Court justices that they will follow biblical principles when they make decisions that affect us, and they will stand firm in the face of opposition. Lord, we all feel the pressure of the times. Help us to make right decisions, the decisions that you want us to make, regardless of the temporal circumstances. We remember the psalmist when he says, "Do not let me be dragged away with the wicked, Lord, with those who are evil, with those who speak cordially with their neighbors, but harbor malice in their hearts." Lord, it's always important when we gather together like this to spend some time in confession, to wipe away those sins that impede our relationship with you. We do this every week, so folks, we just have to think about this past week. What are some of the things we may have said or done or even thought that now we realize we shouldn't have? It's important that we confess those and that we will always remember what the Lord has told us in 1 John. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. So with that great promise, folks, let's take a few moments and silently in our hearts, let's confess our sins to Almighty God. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for hearing our prayers, and we know that you will meet us at the point of our need, Lord, and glorify yourself, Lord. We also claim that great promise, the forgiveness of our sins, which you have stated in your word, but we realize that it is always based upon the work of Jesus Christ on the cross. Lord, help us to always be faithful ambassadors for Jesus Christ, always to be ready to give a reason to people who ask us why we put our faith and our trust in Christ, always ready to love others in your name, and always be ready to give you the glory. Folks, we know, Lord, we know how much you care about each of us. So, folks, let's take a moment right now. What is the one issue or one situation that you are dealing with right now in your life that's difficult for you? Let's take a few moments, lift it up to the Lord, and ask him to help you deal with it in a godly way. Let's do that right now. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers, and we know that you will help us, Lord, whatever that situation is that we have just lifted up. Folks, also, let's take a few moments right now. Let's lift up some people in prayer. We know that our Lord always hears us because we're his children. This is a wonderful privilege that we have where we can lift up people that we know and love before the Lord's throne and ask him to go to them and to help them with the needs that they have. So again, silently in our hearts right now, Lord, folks, let's pray for people and lift them up to the Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for hearing our prayers, and we know you will meet all of the people we have mentioned at the point of their need and glorify yourself in the process. Lord, as we close our prayer, we always pray for our president, the leaders of our nation, and our judges. We always ask you to help them follow biblical principles, as I mentioned before, as they make decisions that affect us. We always lift up people, Lord, who from time to time put their lives in jeopardy to protect us. We think of our police forces, fire departments, Homeland Security, Border Patrol, first responders. We think of our medical community during COVID, Lord. We thank you for all of them, and we pray blessings upon them, and we ask you to protect them. To that end, Lord, we always pray for true lasting peace on earth. We know that won't happen until you return. So every Sunday, we pray that you return as soon as possible. And finally, Lord, we pray that everything we do here this morning is pleasing in your sight, as we do it out of our love for Jesus. And it is in his name that we pray. Amen. Again, now's the time when we take the offering. The plate is in the back. If you could drop it off on your way out, we would appreciate that. But let me pray over the offering. Dear Heavenly Father, again, I thank you for the generosity of your people. And I pray, Lord, that you would guide us and influence us to use these tithes and offerings to further your glory here in this world. And again, Lord, we ask this in Christ's name. Amen. So we're going to change it up a little bit today. We're going to deviate from our study on the life of Jesus. We're going to look at the biblical perspective on abortion. I've given you a handout sheet in your bulletin, which will make it easier to follow along. But again, before we begin, let's ask the Lord for a special blessing. Dear Heavenly Father, as we consider your word and what it has to say about a very, very pressing social issue that we have in our country today, abortion, we pray, Lord, that you would inspire us, Lord, enter into our hearts and our minds and help us to truly understand what your word says. Because as we do that, we know that it helps us have a closer relationship with you, and that is what we are always after. So please bless our time together now, we ask in Christ's name, amen. So I want to start off with a quick question for you, okay? So what if you knew a woman who was pregnant and she already had 8 kids? 3 of them were deaf, 2 were blind, 1 was mentally handicapped, and she had syphilis. Would you recommend that she have an abortion? We'll get to the answer at the end. So I want to start off with some PowerPoints. Can we show those right now? Just real quick, okay, just to help you get some perspective, some facts. Let's get that up here. So pro-choice movement, you know, we've been talking about what's a pro-choice movement? A woman has the right to control her body. I just want to point out to you that a couple months ago, we had a Supreme Court justice confirmed who couldn't even tell us what a woman was. So I don't know. What are they talking about, these women things? What are these things? All right, go to the next one. Okay, so just some facts. Now, the Guttmacher Institute is supported by Planned Parenthood. So, kinda, you know, if you want to think of middle of the road, but probably off to the left a little bit. 63 million abortions in the United States is what we hear now since Roe v. Wade. I did a little research. I wanted to know how big was that number. I looked at the population of the cities in the United States. It's more than the top 55 cities in the United States. New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, you know, Philadelphia, Washington. You got to go down 55 cities to get 63 million. By the way, 50 million people worldwide were killed in World War II. More than that for abortions, 20 million in World War I. Go to the next one. Now, abortion, as you know, or you should know, is completely a racist operation. Margaret Sanger, an avowed racist, started Planned Parenthood, and it targets populations. Black women are 5 times more likely to have abortions than white women are. Go to the next one. This gives you a percentage of where, gee, I wonder where Planned Parenthood facilities are. 79% are in neighborhoods that have minorities. Go to the next slide. Now, this shows you another aspect. The top one is the population in the United States. So about 69%, 70% is white. You got 12.5 Hispanic, about 12.5 black. But notice what the last one, the bottom one says. Look at the abortions. So you have 70% of whites having 36% of abortions. If it was 1-to-1, they would have 70% of abortions. But notice what you have. You have 12.5% of blacks having 30-36% of abortions. You can see how that's a much higher rate. Okay? Go to the next slide. Again, these are just showing declining rates. This is for certain age groups. Again, you can see black, non-Hispanic, and Hispanic are still higher. This is women age 15 to 44. Go to the next one. These are slides I show in my class, by the way. Now, it's hard to get information on this, but this is very important because every time we talk about the abortion issue, what's the first thing pro-choice says? Oh, 18-year-old girl gets raped and you're not going to let her have an abortion. Folks, for reported abortions in the United States, it's less than 2%, okay? Which means 98% are for birth control, all right? Go to the next slide. This is very interesting. In 2004, and this is the only time they did it, Planned Parenthood, the Guttmacher Institute, did a survey on what are the reasons that women had abortions. Look what it says for rape. 0.5%. 0.5%. Okay, you go down the list, what's 19? Done having children, can't afford a baby, not ready. Those are really the big ones, all right? Go to the next slide. So Roe v. Wade, 1973, grants the woman the right to have an unconditional, the unconditional right to have an abortion. And then the final slide, I think, go to the next one. Oh, okay, all right, well, okay. Have you heard of Kathy Barnett? She's running for Senate in the state of Pennsylvania right now. I'm not trying to support her or anything. Her mother was raped when she was 11 years old. When her mother was 11 years old, she was raped and she had the child, and now she's running for U.S. Senate. Okay, just to put all of this in perspective, okay? Okay, so let's go to your sermon scripture. First point I want to make, right? We are created in the image of God. Genesis chapter 1. Then God said, let us make man in our image and our likeness. Let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. By the way, I've given you this handout so you can take the scripture home and maybe you can share it with people who are a little undecided, okay? But why is this important? Folks, the only way that you can unconditionally ground human dignity, it's in the idea that we are created in the image of Almighty God. All other sources of human dignity have been, okay, and will be usurped for other reasons. Let me just give you a few, okay? Sometimes the liberal part of our country who's in favor of abortion says, well, you got to have psychological characteristics. That's what human dignity is grounded in. You know, the ability to reason, the ability to be have consciousness, things like that. Well, here's the problem. What happens when those things go? What happens when you don't have the capability of reasoning the way they set the standard? All right. What happens to your dignity? Your human dignity goes away and you become a commodity. Okay? Sometimes people want to ground human dignity in race, ethnicity, national origin. Well, what if you're not a member of their group? Then you don't have any human dignity. But what would you expect after you teach several generations that evolution is true? Listen, you're nothing but a cosmic accident. Have you reconciled that in your mind yet? That you're nothing but a cosmic accident? Okay? You ultimately become a commodity. Okay? Just think about a few things for a moment. Think about what's going on in our southern border. Are you trying to tell me that you really believe the Democrats think that those people who are coming in on the southern border are human beings created in the image of God? They're commodities. They're future Democratic voters. That's all they are. If they were human beings, they would never allow them to be treated the way they are. And you're well aware of what's going on there. How about the fentanyl epidemic? Biden doesn't care about your children overdosing, because if he did, he would close the southern border and stop the fentanyl from coming in. But he can't do that because he's letting in future Democrat voters. By the way, I think they're going to be surprised, because I don't think those people coming in are going to vote Democrat at all. But that's another issue, okay? By the way, the people who just had 100,000 overdoses, they're just statistics. How about euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide? If you believe in the dignity of human life, you would never support that. We have 11 states in the United States that support that. How about embryonic stem cell research? And I am well aware of the potential that embryonic stem cells hold, but never at the expense of the person. How about reproductive technologies? Oh, that's an interesting one, yeah. You don't know this, I bet. Did you know there's over 50,000 frozen embryos in the United States of America in these companies that do reproductive technologies? Because when they do the artificial insemination, they don't just do it one at a time. They do 20 or 30, and they put them in the woman one at a time, obviously. I don't know any woman that wants 10 children. There's over 50,000 frozen embryos in the United States in giant freezers in these corporations that do reproductive technologies. Well, what do we do with them? Those are just a few ideas. But what do you expect when you brainwash people into thinking that evolution is true? By the way, another point is, you know how we have people talk, well, it's a natural process. Sperm meets the egg, and then there's a natural process that takes it. So, you know, God has nothing to do with it. Yeah, well, they forget very one important thing. The only reason that we have natural processes on planet Earth is because of Jesus Christ. Look at number two on your outline. For by him all things are created, things in heaven, things on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Never forget this, folks. The only reason that electrons revolve around an atom is because Jesus said so. The only reason that the earth revolves around the earth is because Jesus says so. The only reason the earth has a magnetic field is because Jesus said so. The only reason that we have a gravitational field on earth is because Jesus says so. The only reason you exist is because Jesus says so. And the only reason a fetus turns into an adult is because Jesus says so. There are no natural processes. There are only divinely ordained processes that we happen to call natural processes. Now, final point I want to make on this issue, and that is the idea of rape and incest. I just showed you the PowerPoint, talked about Kathy Barnett. Rape at any stage, and you know, one rape is too much. It's horrible, okay? But the fact of the matter is, it does not matter how you come into this world. It does not matter how you come into this world. And that's an idea that we have to reckon with. But I think if society really believed in human dignity, okay, we could make those situations a lot easier than they are now. offer free medical care for women who have been raped, counseling, financial services, adoption services. And if we did everything we could, I know God would bless them, and I know that God would bless us. But we don't do those things. The second point is, of course, we should be punishing the rapist. I, for one, would be in charge of capital punishment, but I'd go for life imprisonment. We'll talk about castration later. So anyway, the point is we are created in the image of God. Number two, life, personhood, individuality begins at the moment of conception. Now, why do I put it that way? Because the liberal left always tries to argue, again, in philosophy, they go, well, you know what, look, the fetus, the embryo, whatever, it's obviously human. It has human DNA. Nobody argues that. But it's not a person. They try to make that distinction. It's the same distinction they try to make with persistent vegetative state, Terri Schiavo. You know that story, right? Okay? Is she a human being? Well, of course she's a human being. She has human DNA, but she's not a person. She doesn't vote, that's for sure. But she's not aware of any outside stimulation. She has no brain waves. Therefore, she's not a person. And then on the other hand, you can have persons that aren't human. E.T., Yoda, and Spock, for example. Flunk you in my class, I will, right? You know, Yoda, obviously, Master Yoda is a person. Or if there's extraterrestrials, they could be persons, but they wouldn't have human DNA. Here's the point I want to make that we need to remember. All of this is nonsense according to the biblical record. It's absolutely nonsense. The Bible makes no distinction between personhood and human being and embryos and conceptus and fetuses and infants, et cetera, et cetera. The biblical position is that new human life, new personhood, new individuality, however you want to describe it, begins at the moment of conception, okay? And let's just look at what the biblical record says here as we take a look at it. One more point, okay? Marianne Warren is a philosopher who tried to say you have to have certain personhood characteristics. You have to have consciousness, reasoning, self-motivated activity, the capacity to communicate, and presence of self-concepts. If you don't have those, you are not a person and you do not have full moral rights. Obviously, the fetus doesn't have those. The woman does, therefore the woman can have an abortion under any circumstances for any reason. Here's the problem. That's the basis for infanticide. That's the basis for infanticide. Go read the laws in Virginia. Go read the laws in New York, the state of New York, infanticide. Okay? This is the basis for genocide, for eugenics, selective breeding. Okay? And then what happens when people don't have these capabilities? Like Down syndrome, for example. Read up on what's happening in Denmark. Are you aware of Denmark? Denmark has a policy where every pregnant woman must undergo a test for Down syndrome for the fetus. And if they find out that it has the characteristics, the genetic code, that it will have Down syndrome, it's not that they force them to get an abortion, but they strongly recommend it. 2017, only 4 babies in Denmark were born with Down syndrome. All the rest of them were aborted. Okay? By the way, the thing that always amazes me is, do you know what the number one reason on planet Earth is for abortion worldwide? Female fetuses. Okay, so all the women in pro-choice ought to think about that, I would think. Okay? Now, let's go to Psalm 139. Listen to this. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. By the way, do you know how many personal pronouns there are in there? 6. There's 6 personal pronouns in this one verse here. Okay? What claim is this verse making about when new human life begins? Moment of conception. Is it making a distinction about personhood and psychological characteristics and blah, blah, blah? No, of course not. The Bible does not make those kind of characteristics. Don't be fooled by the satanic pre-choice movement. How about Psalm 51:5? Surely I was I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Notice the word conceive. Original sin, obviously, is transferred at conception. Job chapter 10, notice the personal pronouns. Your hands shaped me and made me. Will you now turn and destroy me? Remember that you molded me like clay. Will you now turn me into dust? Did you not pour me out like milk and curdle me like cheese, clothe me with skin and flesh, and knit me together with bones and sinew? 9 personal pronouns. What kind of claim is making? Is this passage making about when new human life begins? Is there any distinction here about personhood and psychological characteristics and individual identity? Of course not. Don't be fooled by the satanic pre-choice movement. Look at Job 31:15. Did not he who made me in the womb make them? Did not the same one form us both within our mothers? What kind of claim is this making? They're all over the Bible. We're created in the image of God. Life begins at the moment of conception. By the way, not to get technical on you, but I think you'll find this interesting. There's a Greek word, brephos, B-R-E-F-O-S, okay? It's used in your next passage in Acts chapter 7, verse 19. Listen to this. It refers to the children that were, the newborns that were killed by Pharaoh. Another king, this is talking about Joseph, right? After Joseph passes, another king who knew nothing about Joseph became ruler of Egypt. He dealt treacherously with our people and oppressed our forefathers by forcing them to throw out their newborn babies, brephos, so that they would die. Guess what? That's the same Greek word that is used to talk about John the Baptist in his mother's womb. Look at Luke chapter 1, verse 41. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby, brephos, leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Verse 44, as soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby, brephos, in my womb leaped for joy. Do you see the point? In one passage, it's talking about clear newborn babies outside of the mother already born being killed. The same word is used for what? A fetus that is inside a woman. Life begins at the moment of conception. New human life begins at the moment of conception. There's no differentiation in the Bible about any of these things, okay? So the second point is, new human life begins at the moment of conception. Let's go to the third point that I want to make, and that is, guess what? Jesus was a fetus. Oh, really? Hebrews 2:17, number 9 on your outlines. For this reason, he had to be made like his brothers in every way in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God and that he might make atonement for the sins of his people. Why is this important? Because the incarnation of Jesus Christ is profound testimony of God's affirmation of the sanctity of prenatal life. Think about this for a moment, folks. Jesus Christ could have very easily descended to earth as a 30-year-old man, wandered in from the desert, gone to the temple in Jerusalem, pricked his finger on the altar, boom, put the blood on the altar and then say, it is done, and going back to heaven. And you know what? We would all be saved just as we're saved now. He didn't have to go through a whole human life. But in God's wisdom, he recapitulates the entire human life from conception to death. Think about that. Now, the personal history of the second person of the Trinity, the Son of God, goes back to eternity. He's part of the Trinity, right? He's always existed. But his humanity begins not when he's born of the Virgin Mary, but when he's conceived by the Holy Spirit. His conception, of course, was a supernatural one. But the significant point here is, think about God and his plan. That his Son, when he became a human being, was going to go through the whole human process. Also, by the way, you might find an interesting number 10 on your outline there, Galatians chapter 5. The acts of the sinful nature, okay, that's the sinful nature, are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, all right? I want to focus on that word witchcraft, circle witchcraft. Pharmakia is the Greek word. Sometimes it's called sorcery, and it means, It means medical practices related to like magical drugs, okay? That's what that word means, okay? Magical arts, as the indigenous North Americans would call a medicine man, all right? That's the kind of activity that that's referring to. And it refers to abortifacients, okay? Drugs that have produce abortion. It's not solely that, but that's included in it. As a matter of fact, in a second century AD text, okay, by Cyrenus of Ephesus, who was an early Greek gynecologist, specifically uses pharmakia, that word, to refer to drugs that give abortion, okay? So the third point I want to make is that Jesus was a fetus. Now, let's end quickly here on some misinterpreted passages. I'm just going to give you the one that pro-choice tries to go to convince you that the fetus, the unborn child, is less important than a full-fledged human being. It's Exodus 21, 22 through 25, verse 11 on your outline. If men are fighting and hit a pregnant woman and she gives birth prematurely, and that's a very good translation, but there is no serious injury, that's to the woman, the offender must be fined whatever the woman's husband demands and the court allows. But if there is serious injury, that's to the woman, you are to take life for life, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, et cetera, et cetera. Now, here's the case in point. That word that's translated premature birth in many translations, like the American Standard Version, it says miscarriage. And so the argument goes, well, if two men are fighting and they inadvertently hit a pregnant woman and she has a miscarriage, in other words, the child is born dead, right? What's the punishment? Well, it's not as bad as if she is hurt. Or if she is killed, it's the death penalty. But if the fetus is killed, it's not the death penalty, okay? But the fact of the matter is, as the NIV and many, many older translations used miscarriage, but they changed it because of this research that I'm going to share with you. The Greek word there is yatza, Y-A-T-Z-A, yatza, and it means a premature birth, but it means a premature live birth. And they have since changed that translation because of this whole issue we're talking about. Let me give you some examples. Go to number 12 on your outline in Genesis. This is Rebecca giving birth to the twins, the first to come out. That yatza means to come out. Well, there's the word. The first to come out, being born, yatsa, was red in his whole body, and that's Esau, right? So there's an example of a live birth. Now, the word yatsa can refer to a miscarriage. It can refer to a baby being born dead, but that's only if it's used with the Hebrew word muth, M-U-T-H, which means death. And I've given you a passage in Job chapter 3, verse 11. Why did I not perish at birth, right? And die, muth, as I came out, yatsa, all right, from the womb. But it's that word is not used. That word muth is not used in Exodus chapter 21, okay? Now, there is a Hebrew word specifically for miscarriage, a dead birth, but that is not that's not used, obviously, in Exodus 21. I've given you that passage in Exodus 23. Worship the Lord your God and bless, and his blessings will be on your food and water. I will take away sickness from among you, and none will miscarry. Shakal is that Hebrew word, or be barren in your land. I will give you a full lifespan. So the point is that passage does not, Exodus 21, does not in any way support the fact that a fetus is not as important in the Bible as a woman or a full-fledged, a person, if you will, adult. Now, final principle I want to make, and this is important, is the idea of self-defense. There's no one passage that says, it's okay to, defend yourself if you have to kill somebody. There's no passage that says that. But we have to look at what the Bible's perspective is. So if you go back to Exodus 22, which I've given you number 15, if a thief is caught breaking in and is struck and he dies, the defender is not guilty of bloodshed. But if it happens at sunrise, he is guilty of bloodshed. Now, what's the difference here? Here's the idea. If you're at home at night, 3 o'clock in the morning, and somebody breaks into your house, especially at this time in human history, you don't have electricity, right? you can't tell what is going on. You defend yourself. And if you defend yourself and you kill them, that's acceptable. Why? Well, you don't know why they're breaking into your house. Well, what's the difference? Well, when sun rises and somebody breaks into your house, the idea is you might be able to tell a little better, you know, like if they see you and then they run trying to run away, or if they do they have a weapon in their hand or whatever, you know, you can see that. So the idea is, yes, you can defend yourself in certain situations, okay? But you have to be careful, okay? That really shouldn't even be our first option. If we can run away, run away. If we can protect our family without hurting the other person, do that. But it still allows for self-defense. Also, there's some interesting passages with Jesus. If you remember him in the Garden of Gethsemane in John chapter 18, verse 11, he rebukes Peter for misusing of his sword, but he doesn't tell Peter to throw the sword away. And as a matter of fact, number 16 I've given you, and this is Luke chapter 22, then Jesus asked them, "When I sent you out without a purse, bag, or sandals, did you lack anything?" "Nothing," they said, okay? Then he said to them, "But now, if you have a purse, take it, and also a bag, and if you don't have a sword, sell your cloak and buy one." The idea is that Jesus is saying, now is the time to protect yourself. You always have the right to self-defense. And finally, of course, number 17 is Psalm 82. How many passages in the Bible, myriads of passages, where we're told to protect the weak and the poor and folks like that. Defend the cause of the weak and the fatherless. Maintain the rights and the poor of the poor and the oppressed. Rescue the weak and the needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. So my point is, the final point that I want to make here, and that's at the bottom of the handout I gave you, abortion is only biblically acceptable if the mother's life is in danger. And even then, that doesn't necessarily mean that she has to abort. That's where she has a choice. Like a woman is pregnant and she's diagnosed with cancer, and they tell her you have to have chemo, and she says, "Well, I'm going to hold off until the child is born." You know, that's her decision. That's her decision, okay? Now, before I end, let's go back to the question I asked you. What would you tell the pregnant woman to do? 8 kids already, 3 are deaf, 2 are blind, 1 is mentally handicapped, and she had syphilis. You going to tell her to get an abortion? Because if you did, you just aborted Beethoven. Think about that. Wonder how many Beethovens we've murdered in the 63 million. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for all of the blessings that you give to us, Lord. Help us to be the kind of people that you want us to be, Lord, sensitive to the needs of women who we love dearly. Many of us have married them. Sensitive to their needs, Lord, sensitive to this very, very controversial issue of abortion, but also, Lord, well aware of what your word tells us, and when we follow your word, we will always be blessed. Even if we don't think so, even if we find it difficult to understand, how could I be blessed in this situation? Well, many of us have learned that even if we don't understand, if we follow your word and we're faithful to it, you will bless us. So thank you, Lord, for all the blessings you give to us, and we ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand and sing our song of invitation, shall we? Again, thank you all for coming. There's some sign-up sheets in the foyer. Also, please take home some bread and some pastries. And again, those people that you know and love, you got another opportunity to tell them that you love them, to show them that you love them. Life is precious. I hope that we all appreciate that. So take advantage of the opportunity you have. Amen. Please hear the benediction. May we go forward into the world with a better understanding of all that Christ has done for us, and may we be faithful to him. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.